Thanks very much, Nina. We'll go straight over to Vladimir.
Thank you, and as became very clear with the Nina's presentation.
They have time, actually.
Thank you. So they haven't even, thanks. And as is clear by now, as the famous saying goes, Russia's a country with an unpredictable past, and every new regime in different periods of time seems to be rewriting the narrative to suit their own aims. And in the early 1990s, as thousands of Moscovites were toppling down the statue of Felix Dzerzhinsky, the founder of Cheka, and as the red flag was lowered for the very last time over the Kremlin, it seemed that finally with the end of the Soviet regime came the end of Soviet lies and falsifications. And in fact, in 1992, for several months, there was a court case in the Russian Constitutional Court, court case against the Communist Party. For this case, there were thousands of archival documents declassified and published, and this was actually mainly the demand of Vladimir Bukovsky, who was already mentioned, and he was invited by the Yeltsin administration to be the chief expert at this trial of the Communist Party, and he demanded that these documents be declassified and opened, and they're actually on the web published today, thanks to his efforts back then. But the case carried on for several months, and all these documents proving the purges, the repression, the arrests, the killings, the deportation, all these other crimes of the Soviet Communist regime were opened up. And the case ended in November 1992 with the verdict of the handed down by the court. It was an ordinance which received number 9P. It was dated November 30th, 1992. One of the findings was, and I quote, governing structures of the Communist Party of the Soviet Union were initiators of the policies of repression directed at millions, end of quote. And this was not just a moral judgment, it was a judicial decision by the highest judicial authority in Russia. So communism was condemned not just morally, but I guess legally. And it was from then on that all these all the information on crimes against, crimes against its own people committed by the communist regime were uncovered, and all these mass graves in Bultovo and Levashovo and Komunarka and all these others were opened up and openly discussed after decades of silence. And at the same time, crimes committed against other nations, against other peoples, were also uncovered and discussed and publicized. And of course, the secret protocol of the Molotov-Ribbentrop Pact, for instance, was, its existence was denied for years and decades. And in the waning days of the Soviet Union, in the end of 1989, the Soviet legislature, the Council of People's Deputies, not only admitted its existence, but it passed a resolution condemning the pact and declaring it null and void. The same goes for Katyn, which was already discussed. The Soviet leadership admitted in 1990, during Jaruzelski's visit to Moscow, the Polish president, that Katyn was not, in fact, committed by the Nazis, as was claimed since the 1940s, but it was committed by Stalin's NKVD forces. Documents were not declassified back then by Mr. Gorbachev. It took the end of the Soviet Union, and it took the new Russian president, Boris Yeltsin, who declassified the Katyn documents, including the famous note from Beria to the Politburo, suggesting that these 22,000 Polish officers be disposed with. In 1992, President Yeltsin handed these documents to Lech Walesa, the Polish government. And a year later, in 1993, President Yeltsin issued an apology on behalf of the Russian people to the Polish people for what happened at Katyn, and he went to the Katyn Memorial in Warsaw and laid a wreath with the words "Forgive us." That was a state visit in 1993. And I think, apart from being the obviously morally right thing to do, it's also a sign of strength to give apology where apology is due. It's actually been turning now to the Baltic states, another topic discussed in the first presentation. Going back to the 19th century, the Russian society, the Russian educated society, the Russian intelligentsia had a tradition of sympathizing with the oppressed peoples, under the understanding that no people that oppresses other peoples can be free itself. And we see figures like Yeltsin, Agayov, Bielinski openly sympathizing, for instance, with the Polish struggle for autonomy in the 19th century, and the famous slogan "For your freedom and ours," that the Russian national swobody was. And it was addressed to the Poles in the 19th century, and of course famously became the slogan of the dissident movement in the Soviet Union itself in the 20th century. And so what we saw in 1990 and 1991, when there were initially tens and eventually hundreds of thousands of people coming out of anti-communist rallies in Moscow and Leningrad and other large cities and protesting against the regime and demanding freedom. They were not only demanding freedom for themselves, they were demanding freedom for other oppressed peoples. And we saw, for instance, the biggest demonstration in 1990 with 500,000 people organized by the Democratic Russian Movement in Moscow. Russian demonstrators in Moscow came out not just with the tricolor flags of Russia, which was then banned, of course, but also with the flags that also banned flags of independent Lithuania, Latvia, Estonia, and all these other countries. These were Russian demonstrators in Moscow in 1990. In January 91, when the Soviet leadership sent tanks to Vilnius to crush the national independence movement, President, or then Speaker of the Parliament, Yeltsin, went to Vilnius demonstratively on a solidarity mission and met with Landsbergis and other pro-independence figures and actually signed agreements on cooperation with them, thus sabotaging the planned blockade of the Baltic states, which was being planned in the Kremlin at the time. And it's also very, very important, especially in the context of the current revisionism and what was discussed here before, that in 91, in two binding treaties signed between Yeltsin and Landsbergis in Lithuania and Yeltsin and Ruto in Estonia, the Russian government, never the Soviet Union, but the Russian government officially acknowledged the fact of the forceful annexation of the Baltic states in 1940. So whatever Mr. Putin's revisionists say now, and you know, they basically go back to the Soviet line that the Baltic states joined voluntarily in 1940. The government of Russia, the democratically elected government of Russia in 1991, recognized the fact of the annexation, and it cannot be taken back. Of course, 10 years ago, Mr. Yeltsin was replaced in the Kremlin by a former KGB colonel who publicly stated that the peaceful dissolution of the Soviet Empire was, quote, the greatest geopolitical catastrophe of the 20th century. Mind you, that's the century where horrible genocides and wars and many other horrible things happened, and he called that, he singled out that as the greatest catastrophe. Of course, Mr. Bukowski and other colleagues in the Russian pro-democracy movement say, you know, we consider that there's a bit of a difference in perspective, because we consider the creation of the Soviet Union the greatest geopolitical catastrophe. He thinks it was the dissolution. And sure enough, with many practices of the old regime, like media censorship and falsified elections and political prisoners, came many symbols of the Soviet past. Hina already mentioned the Stalin inscription in the Moscow Metro. It was, of course, one of the first acts of Mr. Putin was to return the Stalinist national anthem as the national anthem of Russia over numerous protests in the year 2000. The memorial plaque of Yuri Andropov, who was chairman of the KGB and mastermind of the campaign of persecution against political dissidents, and he was the architect of the infamous punitive psychiatry strategies. His plaque was restored by Mr. Putin on Lubyanka in Moscow. In fact, there were new monuments erected to Mr. Andropov in Rybinsk and Petrozavodsk during the Putin decade. And in the new school textbooks approved by the Russian Education Ministry, the mass Stalinist purges of the 1930s were called, quote, adequate to the tasks of modernization, end quote, when describing that period. And Stalin himself was described as an effective manager. So this kind of creeping re-Sovietization, you know, was the hallmark of this Putin decade, and of course the Victory Day also was not spared this process. And earlier this year, the authorities in Moscow announced that for the first time in half a century, the Russian capital will be draped with official portraits of Joseph Stalin, because apparently, you know, the celebrations will be incomplete without the commander-in-chief, and you know, he was an integral part of the victory, so he must be celebrated. Of course, it's a tremendous insult to the memory of millions and millions of victims of Stalinist terror, and the first of those victims was, of course, the Russian people, which numerically was the biggest victim of communist repressions. You know, millions of peasants, priests, monks shot dead, writers, engineers, millions and millions of people killed. And this was also an insult to the veterans of the war, who defeated Nazism, because by equating, by trying to link somehow the victory of the Nazis to the defense and the justification of Stalin's regime, it suggests that people were not fighting and dying for their country, for their loved ones, for their children, for their homes, but they were somehow fighting and dying for the Gulag, the Kolkhoz, and the Stalinist regime, which is maybe the greatest insult you can issue to World War II veterans whom this regime is supposedly protecting and honoring. this week, and you know, especially this year, the 65th anniversary, there were numerous protests against the decision by opposition groups, by human rights organizations, by NGOs, and indeed by the veterans themselves. There was a letter from veterans to Lushkov at Moscow Mets saying this is completely unacceptable. I just want to quote a couple of these statements. This one is from Solidarity, the democratic opposition group led by Boris Nemtsov and Garry Kasparov. I quote, "Our people won the war in spite of Stalin, not because of him. We consider the placing of the butcher's portraits on Victory Day a blasphemy, and the decision was called offensive and immoral. This decision condemns hundreds of thousands of Muscovites to commemorate Victory Day with feelings of bitterness and hurt instead of joy," end quote. Yabloko, the Russian Democratic Party, founded by Grigory Yavinsky, quote, "Posters of Stalin are an insult to the memory of our fathers, grandfathers, and great-grandfathers who earned victory over Nazism by their blood and their toil. This decision shows hatred towards the Russian people and other peoples whose genocide was perpetrated by Stalin," end of quote. And even the hierarchy of the Russian Orthodox Church, which on most occasions is usually very loyal to the government, tries not to create conflicts with the powers that be. In the past few years, there are only two instances when the Russian Orthodox Church hierarchy went against the government. The first one was back in 2008 when the late Patriarch Alexei II refused to follow the government in canonically recognizing South Ossetia and Abkhazia separate from Georgia. He actually stated that the Russian Church considers the Abkhazian and South Ossetian churches to be canonical territory of the Georgian Orthodox Church. That was in fall of 2008. And the second instance was just actually this week when there was a statement issued by the Moscow Patriarchate, which read this was concerning the authorities' plans to put up pictures of Stalin. Quote, "Stalin built an inhuman system which cannot be justified by anything, not even by victory in the Great Patriotic War. It was achieved by our people, not by Stalin," end of quote. As part of the civil society protest and campaign against this, there were counterposters prepared by, among other groups, the Russian Memorial Society, which honors victims of Stalinism and communism. Placards like this, which were printed and they were supposed to be put next to the government-installed pictures of Stalin, and these kind of short illustrative messages like this, intended to remind people of the purges, of the killings, of the collectivization. And indeed, since the government tried to make the case that Stalin was such a great commander and indispensable to our victory against the Nazis, putting up posters actually reminding people of his incompetence and his criminal incompetence in the war, especially in the first one. This poster, for instance, this reads, of course, the official slogan was "Arodino za Stalin," "For motherland for Stalin." And these posters by memorial, they read "Arodino za Stalin," "For motherland against Stalin." And this is this poster shows a copy, a facsimile of Stalin's handwritten resolution. This was when Soviet intelligence kept reporting to him that the Germans are preparing an attack. And every time he would dismiss this as his information because he trusted, his partners, his German partners with whom he had signed the pact in 1939. And this particular resolution reads that, this is Timur Kulov, head of the intelligence, it reads that, "Why don't you put your source," and then a popular Russian expletive. These were the counterposters. There were facts and posters that went up, not in Moscow, but in Syktyvkar, in the north of Russia, in the Komi region. Within hours, it was defaced with ketchup, all over it. There was another image of Stalin put up on a passenger bus in St. Petersburg, and within hours, that was defaced to painted over. And end of last week, a few days ago, the deputy mayor of Moscow, Anna Shevtsova, announced that the government had reconsidered its decision and that the posters of Stalin will not be put on the Moscow streets, quote, "for the fear of vandalism," end quote. And because they realized that these pictures wouldn't even last, 2 hours after they were put up. They'd be defaced, they'd be painted over, they'd be broken, all these other posters would be put up, there'd be maybe fights between people, next to them. So this was actually very rare, a very important victory of civil society in Russia over the regime. Not very many of those in the last few years, but this was certainly one. So in concluding, I'd just like to say that, state the obvious, the Russian people and other people of the former Soviet Union can be rightfully proud of the immense contribution to the defeat of Nazism and the genuine liberation of the Jewish people, for instance, who are destined to certain death in Nazi-dominated Europe. It's a source of rightful pride that, you know, it was Russian soldiers who opened the doors of Auschwitz in January 1945 and the other German death camps. And over three quarters of the Nazis' losses in terms of casualties and equipment losses were on the Eastern Front, so it's absolutely certain that Nazism was defeated primarily by the Soviet Union. But at the same time, we must tell the whole truth, and it would be both untruthful and immoral not to recognize that many states in Central and Eastern Europe in 1945 exchanged one occupying power for another. It would be untruthful and immoral for us not to recognize the mass deportations, the killings, the arrests, the falsified elections that installed pro-Soviet puppet regimes in those countries. And indeed, it would be untruthful and immoral not to recognize that the Russian people, the victors themselves, came back in 1945 to witness a new wave in Stalinist purges, which began in 46-47, and many thousands of those soldiers who defeated Nazism came home and were sent back to the Stalinist gulag in the labor camps in the east, in Siberia and east of the Urals. There's absolutely no reason why the Russian people and the Russian state should be making apologies for a criminal totalitarian regime of which it was itself the biggest victim. And this truth is what the democratically elected Russian leaders said out loud in the 1990s. And it is, I believe, the truth that despite the best efforts of the current regime, a great many people in Russia today know, remember, and acknowledge as we prepare to celebrate the 65th anniversary of our victory. Thank you.